Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Brendan. I was really excited when I received the invitation for this talk, particularly since it's part of the World Congress and coincides with that moment. But when I look through the prior speakers of this talk over the past number of years, I really am truly honored to have the opportunity. So thank you for that, and thank you for giving me an opportunity to give you my angle on where I think we are with IBD treatment, really more so where we're going. But I hope to give a message that I think we need to change the way we're doing things with our patients with inflammatory bowel disease, and there's really a great opportunity for us, and now's the time to do it. Although my learning objective is to describe how IBD patient care can be improved by optimizing and individualizing the treatments currently available, really this is my message. I think we're leaving a lot on the table in treating our IBD patients. And if we're waiting for new drugs and new mechanisms of action to come along to save us and save our patients, that's not where the answer lies. It's going to help, but where the answer lies is helping us understand that we have great medications available right now, great treatments, great doctors, but we're not implementing this in the right way for our patients who are fantastic and deserve better from us. And I do think we have an opportunity to do that. I think this has really hurt us over the past couple of years. This is, of course, meant to represent the pyramidal treatment strategies we started with over a number of years, or this somewhat confusing top-down, bottom-up strategy, which really seemed to imply that we have to make a choice, that we either treat people from the bottom up and start with prednisone and 5-ASAs, or we make a choice to start with early intensive therapy with combination of drugs. And I believe that's confused us, because that implies that there's one way to treat patients, and you can open a textbook and read the algorithm and follow a treatment guideline and you'll get there. And of course, that's not the case. Every patient with inflammatory bowel disease is different, and we have to be very thoughtful about that individual patient and what they deserve at that moment in time of their disease, whether it's newly after diagnosis or after years of therapy, where we have to make a change. And the trouble is, for 10 years now, we've been talking about this idea of early intensive therapy and recognizing that we could really make changes in the way we care for patients. Remember, this was published in 2008. This is the famous DeHaan's top-down strategy that we learned about. And look at the deltas they saw in this study. In this randomized control trial, you saw a 20% delta in remission rate and a 40% delta in mucosal healing rates when we treated patients early in the course of the disease with a combination of effective drugs. Now, this study wasn't perfect, but it certainly taught us that we can do things differently and treat our patients more intensively early before waiting for complications to occur. The trouble is, over the past 10 years, we're not doing this, and we're actually not making much progress in changing the treatment algorithm. And I'll walk you through this diagram to understand why I'm saying that. This was work we actually just presented as a poster just today or earlier at the session. And we are far from giving top-down therapy. This is something called a Sankey diagram. What this represents are all the different treatment pathways somebody can take when they're starting on treatment with inflammatory bowel disease. This comes from a nationally representative database from the United States, and this isn't going back to 1998. This is going up till 2016. This is current day, the way we're treating inflammatory bowel disease in the U.S. I have one for your ulcerative colitis, but I'm going to focus just on the one with Crohn's disease. And let me walk you through this, because I think it makes a really important message. Conceptualize this as you're coming to a forest, and there are multiple different pathways you can go down. One might be labeled 5-ASAs or prednisone or immunomodulators or anti-TNFs or combination therapy, and you need to choose which path to send your patient down on. And if that doesn't make them better, they can swerve on to another pass and take a different way of how they're going to treat their disease if they're failing that first line or second line therapy. So here's what we're doing in the United States, again, a nationally representative database of patients in this country, and how we're treating them with Crohn's disease. This is first line over here. Of the 16,000 patients we looked at, 42% of patients are starting on corticosteroids. The number two most popular treatment in the U.S. for Crohn's disease in 2016, 5-ASAs at 35%. It's been almost 10 years that a Cochrane database analysis was presented that said we shouldn't even be studying 5-ASAs for Crohn's disease anymore, yet it's the number two most popular treatment, only behind corticosteroids, and how we're actually treating our patients with IBD. What happens to these patients here is they move on to second-line therapy. And you can see, just to show you the pathway, where most people go is actually stay on corticosteroids. That's this block here. But then you can follow where everybody goes. The next most common is that they go on combination therapy, but that's a combination of 5-ASA and corticosteroids. And then you can follow them through second, third line therapy, and this of course goes out to multiple lines that we can look at. If you wonder how many people are actually treating with combination therapy, like Gert Don showed us 10 years ago, is significantly more effective than waiting for patients to get sick, it's about 3% of patients who get biologic monotherapy and barely 1% of patients who are getting combination therapy. And you might say, well, that's the payers getting in the way, or patients are worried about drugs, or prior authorization's a problem. So surely by second line, that number goes up. And you can see by second line, it really isn't going anywhere, that the biologic therapy is still staying in the low single digits for patients getting treated for Crohn's disease, failing their first line therapy. And then if you wonder what happens to the patient on corticosteroids, do they eventually have somebody figure it out for them and help them? Well, 63% of the patients who get treated with corticosteroids never see another drug. That's the only drug they've ever been treated with, and in fact, some of them got 10 cycles of corticosteroids and nothing else. So clearly there's room for improvement here, but again, you might say, well, this is first line, second line, third line therapy. Eventually, they get on biologics. Eventually, they come back and they're sick enough and the payers don't make a fuss and we're able to use the drugs that we want to treat our patients. But this is looking at overall biologic use that they ever received. And for Crohn's disease, it only gets up to 19%. 19% of patients with Crohn's disease are getting treated with biologics, and for ulcerative colitis, it's only 6%. So again, despite the fact for 10 years we've been talking about early intensive therapy, and we've been seeing the dramatic improvements that we see when we put our patients on biological therapy, especially early on in the course of the disease, there's really only a minority of patients that are actually ever seeing these drugs. I'm not sure whose fault this is. I don't think it's all the payers. Eventually, at least in the US, we're able to get access for this. I can't remember the last time we couldn't get biologic therapy for patients. There are hurdles, but it's certainly not the payers that are holding us back from using these drugs ever. Possibly first line, but certainly not ever. Is it the patients? Is it that the patients are scared and don't want to use scary drugs with side effects that look terrible to them before they're really sick, and only then are they ready to move on to biologic therapy or even immunomodulator therapy? Probably that's part of it, but I would argue that we're actually the problem. I think we impose our fear on our patients sometimes, or we don't help them get over their fears of these drugs and don't spend time telling them that it's not the drugs that are the scariest part of having inflammatory bowel disease. It's the disease itself that's going to cause so much damage and lead to a decreased quality of life, and that's why we want to use these drugs. But oftentimes we're compelled to wait for our patients to be sick enough to really show us they need these drugs until we want to pull them out. And I believe that's completely the opposite of what we should be doing. We should be trying to prevent problems from occurring as opposed to chasing them. Is it litigious fear? Is it a worry that we don't want to use drugs with side effects like lymphoma or tuberculosis or severe life-threatening infections? Of course that's part of it, and that's fair. But again, I would argue the biggest risk we're putting our patients at is not treating them effectively, which far outweighs the risks that come with these medications. And the last part, it's not easy to start these drugs. They're barriers that to me feel like going through an obstacle course every time we want to start a biologic drug for our patient. The first part, of course, is we have to make sure we understand their disease. That takes a lot of work. It's not just asking their symptoms or doing an MRE. It's fully recognizing the extent of their disease so you know your starting point and you can set targets for where you're going to go from there. And then it gets harder. Then you have to have a talk about risks and benefits of treatment. And again, you know, anyone who's ever had a conversation about biologic drugs or immunomodulators with their patients, you recognize that this isn't a two-minute conversation. This is a long, complicated conversation that you have to have with your patients, oftentimes their family members present, that you really have to help them recognize the absolute risk of the side effects of these drugs is very, very small, and that the absolute risk of their disease is actually quite high, and we need to put that in perspective for them. And then the fun starts. Then we work on prior authorization and coverage. And then, of course, once we get on them, we have to manage expectations, the logistics of actually getting them the drug, coming in for infusions, sending it to them, and keeping our patients on therapy. So there's no question it's hard. It's just a matter of why aren't we doing it? And I would say, I think we do too much of this. I think to me, what phone on the shoulder medicine is you're in the endoscopy unit or you're running around the hospital and you get a page from your nurse that your patient's sick. And you say, who's the patient? And they tell you the patient's name. You're not sitting in front of your computer to really think about their disease course, where they've been and where they could be going. You say, what did they do last time they had a flare? What made them better? Oh, he said prednisone made them better. So I say, you know what, put them back on prednisone. I'll see them in the office in 2 weeks or 4 weeks or 3 months or wherever you have that next opening in your clinic, which is unlikely in 2 weeks. And you see them back, and guess what? They felt better on prednisone. And when they sit down with you at that time, when you're talking about immunomodulators and lymphoma or hepatosplenic T-cell lymphoma and using two drugs that require injections and a prior authorization from their insurance company, it sure is easy to take the path of least resistance and say, you know what, why don't you come back in another 3 or 4 months and another 6 months, and we'll see where things are going. I think we do too much of this with our inflammatory bowel disease patients. We probably do too much of this with all patients across all of medicine. But these patients are a lot of work, and we need to put the time in understanding every single time a patient comes in sick or flaring, where they've been in the history of their disease, and what we could do to prevent it from moving forward. So this brings us to the idea of this personalized care, of choosing the right treatment for the right patients at the right time. And it's certainly not just looking at clinical trial results. Remember, clinical trials are what we use to get our drugs approved through federal regulatory committees, not to guide our treatment and tell us exactly what happens in the real world population. In fact, when we looked at this, I did this interesting study with Tina Ha when she was at Mount Sinai Medical Center in New York City, that we looked at everybody who came through their clinic who was on biologic therapy, and only 31% of them would have made it into any registration clinical trial to get these drugs approved. That means about two-thirds of our patients are completely untested in clinical trials and how they respond to biologics. So if you're looking at clinical trials to guide you on what to do next, remember those clinical trials were done to help us get these drugs approved for access for our patients and not to guide us in day-to-day clinical practice of exactly what we're going to do. So when we're choosing Crohn's disease therapy, we have to recognize that there's no way every patient needs top-down, early intensive therapy. But we do need to determine who's high risk versus low risk, and we have to help patients, and I think we have to help ourselves as colleagues understand this risk. But bringing patients into that formula is really very important. We want to identify patients before they have severe disease, before they come to us and say, now I'm really sick, I'm ready to take these drugs. And we need to identify these patients who are at risk for severe disease. And when I say severe disease, I don't mean moderate to severely active disease based on whatever scoring system you need. I mean what you know is a patient with severe disease who gets into trouble and is going to have complications and really can destroy their life if we don't treat their diseases early enough and early on in the course of their care. So what we're really trying to do is predict the future, which is never easy. But we need to start thinking very carefully about how to do this. And this has really been the guide of our work over the past number of years, trying to develop this risk prediction tool. And you can note in the title here that it's not just about risk prediction. It's a patient communication tool to display individualized risks. Now, think back to what I said just a few minutes ago. We can spend all day long talking to our patients about side effects of drugs and trying to calm their fears over taking these medications. But what we really need to do is help them understand the risk of their disease. And if we as providers and our patients can come together and understand where their disease might be going, it's a very different conversation than you're having some abdominal pain and diarrhea and we want to put you on biologic drugs that have black box warnings on them, so please listen to us, I'm sure we're right. And we need to get our patients to buy into this with them. The work that we did started with a normal statistical analysis called a Cox proportional analysis, where we took about 700 patients with Crohn's disease who were very well characterized and did a cross-sectional analysis to identify variables that would tell us which patients are at a higher risk of developing complications of their Crohn's disease, a complication being defined as a stricture, internal penetrating disease, or an abdominal surgery, something that's irreversible. Who are those patients who are going to move on to irreversible Crohn's disease such that no medication is going to work and they need a surgery? And we felt that was relevant to patients and relevant to us and helping us realize who we should focus our best treatments on. you can see the variables here. They're not too surprising. It's where their disease is. Patients are with small bowel disease have a higher risk of complications than those with colonic disease. Patients who come in with perianal disease is a marker for more severe disease and other complications. There are a series of serologic markers and a genetic marker that played into the model. If you're interested in the accuracy of these models and how these models would behave, you first develop it in a calibration cohort. So you have a cohort of patients where you build the model. You would expect the model would behave pretty well in that group of patients because those are the patients you took the data from to decide how the model should look. And a Harrell-Seer concordance index is the way to look at that. Anything above 0.6 or 0.65 is considered to be a pretty good model, and we are very happy to have this come out at 0.73. However, you never know how your model is going to behave until you take it in a completely separate cohort of patients, and that's when you really test it to externally validate the model. And we were thrilled when we brought it to a completely different group of patients who had nothing to do with the first patients we talked about, and the model behaved exactly the same. And in fact, we brought it back to a pediatric cohort of patients, and the model was equally accurate in predicting their time to first complication. So when you come into the model over the next 3 years, how accurately were you predicting their time to develop that first complication? Can we stratify patients from high risk to low risk so that we can therefore pick which patients we really need to focus on with the appropriate therapies? To do this, we couldn't use standard statistical analysis. Remember, we wanted to make a patient engagement tool, not just hazard ratios that we could throw out to our patients, which I'm quite certain won't ring true with them as far as understanding where things are going. I would argue they're not really going to help us and communicate that to our patients either. So we had to turn to a different statistical technique to develop this tool for patients called system dynamics analysis. What this is a methodology to address inherent dynamic complexity of interactions between variables. It's not that different at that level from multivariate logistic regression or any other multivariate analyses that you might do. The novelty here is that it gives us an advantage over traditional statistics such that we can provide real-time individualized predictions of outcomes. We have a simple input control panel that anybody can use, and then it immediately produces a graph so that we can show patients at that point of care what their risk might be over the next 3 years of developing a complication. A nice novelty added to this is we can build on this model over time. We're not done once we present our first model, which I'll show you in a minute, but we can actually add new data to it as we learn about new serologic markers, genetic markers, or clinical features that we can add to enhance and strengthen the model over time. Really, what we've done is tried to develop a tool that takes complex clinical data and turn it into patient-friendly results. I'll show you an example of what the model looks like, and then I'll show you two specific patient examples so you can see how we've been using this both as a research tool but also starting to use it in clinical practice at our institution. You'll see here that we've really simplified this for a number of reasons. I'm very interested in working with patients in a qualitative way to understand exactly what they're looking for, and we spent quite a bit of time learning from patients and how they would like to see this displayed. And you might notice, for instance, there are no percentages along the y-axis here. And that's because patients told us they actually didn't care that much if they were at an 82% risk versus a 75% risk. They simply wanted to know where they were on the spectrum of low, medium, to high risk, and that's why we color-coded it and make it very easy for them to interpret. We could have modeled this out 5 or 7 years, but again, patients told us that really most impactful to them was over the next 3 years. They wanted to understand what was going to happen to them over the course of their disease. When they get this, it's personalized for them. It has their name on it. It shows their disease phenotype. If they click on the button, this is a live website that we can send to them. They click on the button that says your Crohn's disease, and it tells them why they're at certain risk, whether it's high or low. And then in fairly clear language tells them what we're looking out for here, which are the complications related to Crohn's disease. So let me just show you two examples of patients came in. This is an amazing 28-year-old guy who came from the state of Maine. Although it might look close to you on the map, this is probably about a 6-hour drive for this gent who comes from northeastern Maine over to Dartmouth-Hitchcock Medical Center. And he had what we would all agree is moderately active ileal disease, about a 15-centimeter segment or so of ileal disease. And he couldn't understand why his doctors locally wanted to put him on biologic therapy. In fact, he came kind of angry that people wanted to, quote, push him on biologic therapy when he felt quite well smoking marijuana a couple of days, and he really didn't understand what the big deal was of changing therapy because he came in and felt pretty good. He was able to play music. He was actually opening a recording studio in his local town, and his life was finally going in the right direction. That reading the side effects of the biologics that were prescribed to him really concerned him and put him off. So he was a patient in our clinical trial, and we put his numbers through the model, and this is the result we got. And you can see that even over a one-year period, he's at very high risk to develop complications of their disease. And what was amazing is within 24 hours of receiving this, he called our office and talked to my nurse. He called at 8:01 a.m. in the morning and begged us to start him on the medications as soon as possible that we had talked to him about, because he was now not concerned about the medications, he was concerned about his disease. And in fact, we put him on a combination of adalimumab and methotrexate, and as I typically do, brought him back for a follow-up colonoscopy somewhere between 6 and 12 months or so, and he had near complete mucosal healing with appropriate therapy early on in the course of his disease before any complications developed. But let me show you a contrasting patient. This is another amazing 20-year-old woman who played soccer for a college up in Burlington, Vermont. She's one of these amazing people who held down two jobs, played varsity soccer, and was doing great in school, and also now is dealing with a new diagnosis of Crohn's disease. And she also came down not because nobody knew what to do with her, because she had mild to moderately active disease. It was because she was completely put off by the fact that her doctors were insisting that she go on early combination therapy, just as the literature shows we should be doing in patients like this. And she was so frustrated, she wanted a second opinion and came down. And she thought if she just kept active and kept playing soccer and ate well, she was going to be just fine. And when we put her through the model, in fact, her prediction was much different than the first gentleman I showed you. And she kind of called back about 24 hours after getting this too with a very different tone. She said, you know, haha, I told you I didn't need any drug. Can we just keep an eye on things over the next few years and see how things go? And I said, sure, let's keep an eye on things, but let's not give it a few years. Let's give it about 6 or 12 months and repeat a colonoscopy. And in fact, with her activity level, eating well, adding some supplements to her diet, she had complete mucosal healing on no therapy 9 months later. So I realize this is an N of two example, but we just presented a DDW a few months ago that this actually holds up pretty well in our patient population that we're following prospectively over time, and we're really excited where this is and where it could be going. So we need to help patients understand the implications of their disease, and that's really become the focus of my office visits now, particularly when people are early on. We don't want people with IBD to be too scared of their disease, but I think they need to be a little bit more scared than they are, and we have to find that line of making patients respect the fact that this is irreversible, destructive disease that will not turn around with any medications after damage has occurred. So how can we move forward and work with our patients to make them understand this? And part of it is helping them understand their risk, but part of it is being proactive and let them recognize that we're going to stay on top of this and in front of it, as opposed to chasing bad disease, which we too often do with our patients with Crohn's disease and also with ulcerative colitis. I was thinking about this recently, of the difference between proactive and reactive. And although I initially had some slides in here talking about therapeutic drug monitoring and proactive versus reactive testing, I don't intend to talk about that today. But just to put us through a thought exercise of where we are with inflammatory bowel disease care. If you have a patient who says, well, when it bothers me, then I'll turn out it's time to fix it and I'll come to you for help. And that's how we treat things like destructive diseases like knee osteoarthritis. We're not using early top-down therapy with destructive joints when it comes to osteoarthritis. Essentially, your orthopedic surgeon will say, when it hurts you enough, come back in and we'll deal with it. And that's the definition of reactive treatment. Now, I don't want to try to draw an analogy between inflammatory bowel disease and any type of cancer, but if you think of colon cancer, something we deal with all the time, there's no question that this is something that we need to get on right away. The moment we make this diagnosis, there's no waiting for stage 3 or stage 4 cancer. We have to immediately jump on this, and that's the other extreme of proactive care. So it does make you think there's a spectrum in here, and where would inflammatory bowel disease sit? Where in your practice does inflammatory bowel disease sit? I worry, based on the data that I showed you earlier, that we're treating this much more reactively than we are proactively. And I would argue that this should be much closer to the way that we treat colon cancer than the way that we treat knee osteoarthritis. And we have to be thoughtful when we see this patients that if we wait for them to be sick, it is oftentimes too late and the drugs are never going to work. You've probably seen this figure many times, but the point I want to make here is that patients are having flares of their disease and then feeling well in between. Remember the phone on the shoulder medicine problem, is they get corticosteroids, and guess what? 90% of the time, people feel great with them. So it's those in-between times, that blue line when it's flat, when they're not flaring, is when it's most dangerous, because that's when damage is building up and they're getting into trouble. We oftentimes treat our patients here, which is after they've had a few flares and damage has already begun. And I would say we need to frame shift our treatment and move it up in the treatment algorithm, just like we've learned and we know we're able to treat better, but we need to be thoughtful about when we start these treatments, which is soon after diagnosis in the right patients, as opposed to waiting until too long. The last point I'll make is about patient-centered care, is understanding what their disease is like and what do they need most when we're thinking about treating them and engaging them in the process, as opposed to writing them a prescription and sending them away. You might recognize this from Maslow's work in the world of psychology. And he published this in the 1940s, talking about that you need some basic safety needs filled before you can think about self-actualization and self-efficacy. I think it's the same thing in our patients with inflammatory bowel disease. We as providers are thinking about this top part of the pyramid. We fight at meetings like this about histologic healing or mucosal healing, or what's the GABO score that we need to get patients down to prevent flares. And guess what? They're far from that when most of the time that we're talking to our patients. They just want to leave the house and not have to worry about incontinence and be able to work and not worry about hospitalizations. And we have to recognize that our patients are very often in a different place in their lives than what we're thinking about in fine-tuning their care and pushing their doses and checking therapeutic drug levels. We need to do that too, but that's our job. But our other job, which is equally important, is recognizing where our patients are in this spectrum. And it's hard to do this, but we try to understand what patients are most scared of. This is a publication we put out last year where we asked our patients with ulcerative colitis what they're most scared of. I spent the first 12 years of my career trying to figure out how scared patients were of medications with side effects, again, like lymphoma, tuberculosis, and sepsis. But it turns out if you ask patients what they're really scared of is dying of colon cancer, having an ostomy, or not being able to do the things that they'd like to do. In fourth place was possible side effects. And that's why I think that we're imposing our own fears about these drugs onto our patients many times. And we need to realize that our patients are worried their disease is going to control their life more so than they're worried about the drugs causing side effects. So if you want to be patient-centered, there are a lot of different things you can do. A great program that I'm working on with the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation is a program called IBD Chorus, which is a national quality improvement program that we call a learning health system that we currently have 30 medical centers across the country, both community practices and academic practices, working together to help improve the care for patients. We've put years into this work, but the most important thing we've done is develop this question that every single patient gets asked when they come into the office visit, which is, what's your number one concern or goal related to your inflammatory bowel disease? And then we point out to them that it could be related to a specific symptom, but it also could be worry about the future, financially, how is this impacting them, or how IBD might impact an upcoming life event, such as a wedding or a vacation. And by using that, I have absolutely changed the way I talk to my patients in the office. Because now, instead of waiting for that last 30 seconds where they tell me what's really bothering them, I start my office visit with this question and really can focus on what they need and then talk about the fine-tuning logistics of getting their drugs started, keeping them on them at the right doses and optimized to the best we can. So in summary, I unfortunately feel like we're not doing a very good job getting the right medications to the right patients and at the right time. I don't believe we're optimizing our care for IBD, but we do have the tools to be better at this. We have very good drugs. We know their safety over many years now, and we understand, and we're starting to understand, which of our patients are at higher risk than others so that we could focus our best therapies in an intensive way on the patients who need it most. But we do need to refocus our care. I think this is a moment that we need to pause and think about what we've been doing. Think about the number of patients who are actually ever seeing biologic therapy. And we need to think about giving personalized, proactive, and patient-centered care. So again, Brian and Brennan, truly honored to be here. Thank you very much. I appreciate the time.